Hi. So as mentioned, my name is Chris Noessel, and I'm here to talk to you today about some material that I have co-developed with my co-author, Nathan Shedroff. I think he is meant to be in the audience, so if you're here today, hey, Nathan. Everyone say hi to him during a break. To give you a little background about what I'm going to be telling you about, 7 years ago, Nathan asked of me out loud. He said, hey, what do you think the relationship is between the interfaces that we work on in our sort of day-to-day jobs and the interfaces that we see on screen in science fiction movies and television? It seemed like a simple question. So 7 years later, we had watched a ton of sci-fi. We had screen capped every interface that we could possibly see, loaded it up into an online database, and then tagged each of those interfaces. We took a look at the resulting tag cloud and investigated really deeply those sort of largest tags that had appeared out of the cloud. Then in fall of last year, so 6 years later, we finally published a book called Make It So, Interaction Design Lessons from Science Fiction, published through Rosenfeld Media. And for about a year now, we just sort of passed the anniversary mark, I've been keeping a blog at sci-fi-interfaces.com slowly revealing that online database that we used. So it's sort of a background of the material that we're going to be, that sort of informs this conversation. The question I'd like to sort of spend my 15 minutes with you guys on is one that we get when we go around the world and we talk about our book or some of the material or do interviews. One of the most common questions that I get on those interviews is one that gives me a little bit of a pause. It's, what's the best sci-fi interface you've seen, or what is the worst? That seems like a simple question. So I took sort of my very sciencey approach to it, and I took all the interfaces that I had and I mapped them out on two axes. The first axis is how much beer did I spit out of my mouth when I saw it on screen the first time? And the second axis was how well did it sort of bear up to very close investigation? And what I'm going to do to you, or what I'm going to do to you, what I'm going to do for you today is actually share with you sort of the extremes of this plot. And anyone looking too closely at these dots will note it's actually the constellation Orion, so take the scienciness with a bit of salt. In the lower left part, I shouldn't have to explain this movie to you, but we're going to be taking a look at the worst of the best interfaces. This is from Minority Report, a film that is now over a decade old. And I hope I don't have to explain it to you, but in this scene, we're going to be seeing John Anderton using a gestural interface in order to sort of investigate some precognitive visions of crimes that are about to happen. I'm not going to play the whole clip. The reason why I call this sort of one of the best is that it's logically consistent. It's pretty cool. It's actually useful for what John Anderton is doing in this scene, scrubbing through pre-crime. The reason I say it's the worst of the best is since this movie came out, almost every client I have at my day job at Cooper comes and mentions this movie for surgeries and, you know, financial investigations. It's kind of crazy. The movie was sort of a watershed moment. This burned the possibility in its audience's mind of, hey, gestural interfaces are possible. They're cool. They're real. Even to the notion of natural user interactions. But it's the worst because we just can't get away from it. So that's sort of the lower left part of my graph. In the upper right-hand part of the graph, I want to talk to you about the best worst. So this scene comes from one of my favorite campy movies of all time, Logan's Run in 1976. Awesome. If you haven't seen the film, let me set it up a little bit for you. This is Logan 6, and he is a cop in this hedonistic society. And his job is to go and sort of chase down people who are trying to evade their sort of government-sanctioned death date. But after a hard day of chasing down and killing fugitives, he wants to sort of relax at home and add a little sex to his evening. To do that, he grabs a remote control and uses a device called the circuit. So he starts to tune the device in. He slowly tunes in the first potential candidate who likes what he sees. Not Logan's speed. So he tunes in again. So marvelously goofy, where he sees Jessica Five, who ends up being the second protagonist for the film. He likes what he sees, she's a little curious, but he grabs her by the hand and invites her into his home. This is so awful. And I know where this came from. There were a couple of movie producers in Hollywood who were like reading Penthouse and high off their asses. And they were like, dude, we're movie producers. We can make this. But it makes no sense from the user's point of view, especially Jessica. Like, we're talking about the male gaze in cinema writ large. What happens to her body when she's sort of mistuned? Like, what if he put the device down when she's halfway tuned in? And there's no preferences on the thing? Like, if he wasn't interested in a dude, why did he have to go through that whole thing? So it just makes zero sense. It is a miserable interface. For everybody involved. Like, to get off of the circuit, she actually has to go through a dude's home, even if she's just tired. And she doesn't know where she is, so she's gotta like find her way back to her apartment. It's silly. The reason I would consider it the best is it's sort of delightful and sort of cheesy, better than campy. And actually, it beat Chat Roulette to the point by almost 30 years. So the cool thing about Logan's Run is they were earnest. They thought this was going to be a cool thing. And of course, 30 years in hindsight, we're like, what? But this is a runner-up. This is one that Pixar created called Lifted. It was a short before Ratatouille. But this time, the sort of filmmaker is in on the joke. Usability expert's nightmare. So Lifted is in on the sort of, the Pixar is in on that joke, right? The whole premise of the comedy is that he's faced with this enormously unusable interface in order to try and abduct humans, and it's really delightful. And for that reason, like, they knew what they were doing. It's a sort of a different category than the Logan's Run. It's horrible, but they kind of knew it. So if we head to the upper left-hand part of my science-y diagram, we're going to take a look at one of the most hilariously bad interfaces that we have come across in science fiction. And George Lucas is going to be mad if he's in the audience. So I'm going to show you three interfaces, actually. All of them are aboard Padme's Royal Starship. And in the first scene on the far left is from Attack of the Clones. She is taking a hologram that is coming in from the far side of the galaxy and routing that back to Coruscant, the sort of planet-sized city, so that everyone can see the same hologram. Kind of a complex thing to accomplish with an interface. In the second clip, also from Attack of the Clones, she is going to be using that exact same interface in order to summon a star chart, kind of Wikipedia for Star Wars, where she's summoning up something in order to illustrate a point that she's discussing with Darth Vader. And the far right one, Revenge of the Sith, we're going to be seeing her using the same interface in order to land her starship onto Coruscant. Also a very sort of complicated thing that one might need to do with an interface. So again, routing a hologram, summoning a star chart, landing a spaceship. Let's watch. I know we coddle royalty, but come on. This is pretty much an any key. To land your spaceship, press any key. So there is really no excuse for this. It's just sort of lazy filmmaking, and they thought we wouldn't notice. My apologies if you work there. But there's really no explaining this, right? So in the upper left-hand corner of just hilarious worst, I love to sit and watch this again and again. There's just no excusing that interface. So in the dead center, of course, doing our investigation across 6 years, we went into some pretty non-blockbuster neighborhoods in order to investigate science fiction that was unusual or that certainly we hadn't seen before. And one of the most delightful ones that we saw was from this film. It's a French film called Chrysalis. In the scene we're about to watch, Dr. Brueger is a world-class heart surgeon, and she is working on a patient remotely in Mexico City. Yeah, that's really French, isn't it? That has nothing to do with the surgery. So through this very beautiful interface, it's both sort of lovely to look at. It really makes sense when you investigate it sort of over time about what her gestures are doing, what her task is, what her goals are in using the interface. And it's really engaging. It's actually a pretty good model, both for the real world and actually played out really well sort of as a narrative device, across this film. So for that reason, this is one of the best interfaces that we saw, but not a lot of people know about it, so we list it as the unknown best. I have one more clip to show you before I sort of give you the big answer to the question. This one was a surprising best for me. We're going to be taking a look at, does anyone know? The Fifth Element. This is a film from 1997 by Luc Besson. And in this scene, we're going to see our heroes trying to figure out how to use these stones and these pillars in order to fire a weapon that hasn't been fired for a number of millennium. The brilliance comes in from how they figure it out.
Got it figured out, Father?
This one, should be fine.
You don't know how all this works?
Theoretically, yes.
Theoretically?
Now that the four stones should go around, the fifth element should be in the middle, and then the weapon against evil should work.
You've never seen this work before, have you?
No.
Every weapon has a manual. I'm sure this has one, too. That's it. Match up the symbols. Go, go!
So very simply, sort of and very tensely, they figure out how to fire this weapon. And if you do the math, the combinatorics, the odds of their being able to figure this out without these sort of simple cues on the stones and the pillars are about 1 in 2.5 million. So it's actually a really brilliant design, though why the original designers made it so complicated, I can't say. For being a piece of science fiction interface that is sort of very subtle in its presentation, and yet teaches us loads about sort of core interface issues of affordance and constraints, it's actually a very, very brilliant interface. And that's why I call that sort of our surprising best. So these six clips are those that I would like to sort of map out for our extremes in order to help answer that question. What is the best science fiction interface that we've seen, and what's the worst? Well, just like the interface design that we do in the real world on a daily basis, the answer is, it depends. Thank you very much.